One important contribution from Frankl is that he restored spirituality to psychology. Okay? He said, logotherapy is spiritual therapy. Since meaning therapy is based on logotherapy, I say the same thing. I say meaning therapy is spiritual therapy. Earlier, I talked about faith, faith in higher power, faith in God, faith in some transcendental value, faith in something secret. Okay, if nothing secret in life, then you're in trouble. Okay, then you're in trouble. And ultimate meaning. Ultimate meaning is actually spiritual meaning. You know why? Nobody can ever realize ultimate meaning. Ultimate. Go as high as you can. The best value, you know, ultimately, there's justice. Ultimately, there is perfect joy. Ultimately, we'll meet God face to face. Ultimately, everything makes sense. Right now, we are here. We only see it through a glass darkly. We can't see things clearly. But ultimately, everything becomes clear. Ultimately, there are no more tears, no more pain, no more sorrow. So there's hope, right? Hope. Hope keeps you alive. So ultimate meaning is part of spirituality. The second part is that to be fully human is to become fully engaged in pursuing self-transcendence and assume full responsibility for one's life. I've done a lot of research on self-transcendence. I spent 3 years in University of Chicago under a Templeton grant, study of self-transcendence. See, Frankl defined meaning in terms of self-transcendence. Okay? Meaning is not just, any value, anything you like, but do that value you like. Frankl is saying, all values are not the same. All goals are not the same. All purposes are not the same. The purpose that can really get you off the ground and to become your best is self-transcendence. Transcendence, put in simplest term, self-transcendence means that take your eye away from you. A heart attack. Take your eye away from you to God, to other people. That makes a big difference, right? You always think about, me, poor me. Your wife is miserable. But it's just saying, What can I do for my wife, for my husband, for my parents, for God, for my church, and for others? You turn from self to others, to God. Then you'll be a different person. That's the beginning of living a meaningful life. The beginning of living a spiritual life. Not I, but Christ. Right? Not I, but Christ. Not I live, but Christ lives in me. Right? That's what Christians say that. The Buddhists will say what? Not I, but Buddha. Right? Is it a switch? From I to something bigger. Meaning is self-transcendent because your life will have meaning when you present something that transcend your self-interest, transcend time and space. Now, this is a particular tool for older people, for people who work with palliative care, hospice care. You're working with people dying, they're waiting to die. The world is fading away. They got nothing to look forward to. You know, it's very saturated with the palliative care thing. Anyway, it's because when you get there, you're waiting to die. So that's the time to realize how important there's a nurse, you know, he's retired now. I mean, she developed self-transcendence skill for elderly. When they're dying, when they're very old, they had to learn to transcend time, space, and things of the world, and to reach out to a new world, a transcendental world, a spiritual world. If you cannot make this turn, you cannot look forward to. Okay? So transcendence is a very important part of spirituality and meaning. Now, here is a faith checklist I have developed. You can check for yourself and use this to check your client to see where they are with respect to faith. Now, if a person is atheist, they only believe in material things, will they have any faith? You do a research to show that the lower the score in faith, the worse off you are in well-being. Yeah. You have no faith, you have no well-being.
Question.
Yes?
While we're on permission, I don't know how to ask this question, but sometimes I wonder if there is, I don't know if the word is permission, if there is freedom to use spirituality approaches in therapies that are going on at the hospital. I'm saying that because I'm an outpatient and I got a lot of healing, and I continue to get a lot of healing through the dimension of spirituality. Not just spirituality, but spirituality married to the other psychologies, psychiatry. And so sometimes I just feel there's almost a shyness or a reservation, you know, especially with certain professionals, you know, whether one as a patient, whether we can actually be free about it and approach it and well into it. Are you following what I'm saying?
Partly. You are saying that that as an outpatient, you need spirituality from psychology, psychiatry, what else?
I guess what I'm saying is that I'm experiencing a need for that to happen. Like I was blessed, I use the word blessed, I was blessed to experience that with a psychiatrist here while before he retired, until he retired. But after that, you know, I'm still searching. Anyway.
Thank you. Can anybody help me a little bit?
What I was saying is that the search is a very important part of spirituality.
Yeah. Okay.
The process. One doesn't arrive. One is not arrived. One is always in the state of becoming.
Okay. One more.
Quite a bit. And I'm having difficulty finding what I need.
And I say, as a patient, you certainly have to have your say and speak up, and yes, and ask to have spirituality be a part of your treatment. Does that address what you were?
Yeah, that's right on. That's right on. There is a difficulty.
So, my experience is that as a nurse, sometimes individuals equate religion with spirituality, and don't understand the difference between the two and lock them in together. And if they're not religious, they're very hesitant perhaps to go down that spiritual path because they think it's religion. I have a 16-year-old son who is very black and white with his thinking. And, you know, I never have taken him to church or anything like that. And he is anything to do with spirituality, he equates it to religion. But that checklist, if I show that to him, he'll understand it better. And for preparing him how to go through his life facing adversity, I think he needs to understand that spirituality piece.
I just wanted to say that most people are not aware that most chaplains in the hospitals in Ottawa are trained psychotherapists, and spirituality doesn't necessarily equal religion for them either. And the psychologists don't think of asking the chaplains to participate in client care very often. So we're kind of under-chaplained in the hospital, but that is a resource that is available that people don't think of.
Thank you, Dr. Wong. Something came up in the last 2 days with respect to the black hole. And this is the first time in the history of humanity that we have ever had a picture of a black hole. And this brought on discussion about faith, spirituality, and what am I going to believe now? And one of the statements said, I think I better believe in God because looking at the big picture is too scary. When we go through difficult times, when we are facing cancer, or even if we're in remission, we sometimes want to know what's next. And these are people at their most vulnerable time in life when they're asking these questions. So we need to be able, in a psychotherapy system, to be able to express ourselves without having the big bomb coming at us saying you're not allowed to believe, you're not allowed to talk about religion, or whether you are a Muslim or Christian, a Hindu or whatever, right? You have the right to talk and express yourself because that's part of healing, whether the therapist agrees or doesn't agree. And going back to that black hole, I am sure, because that black hole, by the way, is not the full picture. If they had have made a complete picture of the whole thing, they would not have been able, this is the latest news, to capture the entire thing because they don't have the entire one. This is so big, right, to us that we really need to say to ourselves, we need freedom to express, and meaning is a very important thing. What does this mean to me? Not what this means to you or to anybody. What does this mean to me, and how am I going to function within that?
I just wanted to respond to the client in the room. You're right that 80% of psychologists ignore spirituality. That's what the research suggests. And they don't necessarily use resources like chaplains, as you suggest. But there is a resource in the city. So I'm a psychologist and a professor at St. Paul University, and we train all our psychotherapy students in spiritually integrated psychotherapy. So that's defined broadly. We use a lot of Paul Wong stuff and a lot of second wave positive psychology stuff in training our students. So about a quarter of the room here, all from St. Paul, so all excited about Paul Wong. But if you're looking for spiritually integrated psychotherapy, any of the St. Paul's trained students or the psychologists working there all integrate spirituality into their therapy, whether it be meaning or connection with a higher power, depending on the client and what's relevant for the client.